I knew I wouldn't get a big amen there, except for the people who are givers. When we don't trust God, when He's given us a promise in His Word, how can we expect to live a life of victory? Unbelief is a thief that will rob you of every promise that God has made. Tap your neighbor and tell him, I'm going to annoy you the rest of the service if you don't say amen. Tell him, I'm going to annoy you. Yes, I'm going to annoy you. And I want to tell you something that unbelief will do. Unbelief will make you say things out of your mouth that will literally defy God. The Israelites said, why did you bring us out here? To kill us? Did you bring us out here in this desert place to kill us? No. First of all, God didn't bring them out into the desert. The desert was only a bypass to the victory. I want to tell somebody in this room right now, what you're going right now through, what's going on in your life right now, is only a bypass to your victory. How you act and react on this road of testing and trial will determine how far you go into your land of promise. I hate to say this, but it's true. Any believer that thinks it's easy, that every day of your life is like picking fresh peaches off of a tree, has never really lived too long. I'm looking at this man, Daniel, right here. Just a couple of years ago, between life and death, a heart condition, a problem, bypasses. But what you don't understand is somehow walking through that, now God has opened doors for them. They're going to be in Colombia real soon. They've been traveling into these South American and Central American countries and doing things that they could have never dreamed of in their life. But having passed through the hell they passed through, they now know that God had a purpose and a plan, and so did the devil, to try to stop his life. But I'm telling you today, he didn't win. Somebody ought to give God a big praise right now. That was a hand clap. I'm talking about a praise. A praise is not just a hand clap. Look at chapter 4 of Hebrews in verse 1. And I'm quoting to you from the English Standard Version of the Scripture, not the King James. While the promise of entering his rest still stands. Somebody say, still stand. Let us fear lest any of you should have seemed to have failed to reach it. For good news came to us just as to them. But the message they heard did not benefit them because they were not united by faith with those who listened. For we, I'm going to say me. Because I don't know who else is thinking the way I'm thinking this morning. So I'm going to just say me. So I have believed and enter his rest just like he said. Amen. Do I have anybody that's going with me today? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. I have about 15 hands over here. Do I have anybody that's going into that rest with me today that's decided I'm not going to live this crazy life like it's going on in my nation right now, the nation that I grew up in? Let me tell you something, folks. I was recalling something yesterday in my neighborhood where I grew up in Staten Island in New Brighton, which now you have to watch everything you do walking down the street. When I grew up in that neighborhood, we did not have a key to the locks in our house. We never locked the doors when we went out. Now we have alarms on everything. Our nation has been corrupted by evil leadership. And the church world is asleep. It's afraid to address things. And yet in all of the situations we live in, there are some of us that have decided, while we're troubled at what we see, we will not allow it to rob our rest in God. We who have believed enter that rest. I want you to notice what that scripture says. It says that the gospel or the good news was preached to them as much as it was preached to us, but it was not received by all of them that heard it. It's amazing over the years of ministry. You can sit in a church like this and hear the same message that I'm preaching or somebody preaches, and somebody will say, I got it, I got it. And somebody will say, another service. It's one of the most troubling things we go through as leaders in leadership. How is it that somebody gets it, Steve? And somebody sitting right around where you're sitting just doesn't care. Except when they get in trouble. And we've all been there, so don't think that you're special. We've all been there. When we get in trouble, we know who to run to. But when everything is going good, we don't run to Jesus. He's the option that we have when we have problems. But when we don't have problems, we don't care very much. Amen. I'm preaching better than your amen. The gospel was preached to them like it was preached to us, the writer of the Hebrews said. But it was not mixed with faith in them that heard it. It is faith that brings you out of your crazy place in life. It is faith that sustains a divorced woman who has been abused by her husband and is raising 3 or 4 children. It's faith that keeps you when your house is foreclosed on. It's faith that keeps you when you've had miscarriages and miscarriages and miscarriages. And now you're standing strong because now you know that on May the 4th, a little baby's going to be born to you that they told you it would never happen. Hallelujah. Somebody don't know what I'm talking about in here. Somebody doesn't know what I'm talking about in here. You and I must get back to basic faith 101.
Amen.
God, I trust you. God, I believe your word. God, I'm standing strong. God, I'm going to praise you no matter what I'm feeling like. If I could get some praises in the house today. If I could get some people who just know how to praise God right in the middle of their circumstance. The word was not mixed with faith in them that heard it. And God said, and I swore in my wrath, they will not enter into my rest. Although his works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works. God didn't rest because he was tired. God rested for an important reason, because it was a symbolic, prophetic announcement that even in the midst of everything you're doing, you can come to a place where you have to reflect and think back of all that God has done. Oh, somebody say amen with me. I said, somebody say amen with me. I don't think that there's a person in this room that can not have a testimony of how God blessed you in your life and brought you to where you are today. If I were to ask you to write your testimony, you'd think back of how you were protected in a car accident or from when you were a child. Come on, somebody shout amen. Look at our daughter Jacqueline running around here as our media head now. She was born with collapsed lungs, hyaline membrane disease. The doctor said, we don't know what's going to happen with this child. I said, I know what's going to happen. I stood by that nursery, and for 2 days, I spoke the word of God, and all of a sudden, like in a miracle thing, like somebody blew on those lungs, and they opened up and became perfect lungs again. Because there's a destiny in people. Now she's hiding. Now she's hiding. There she is. She's hiding. Give God a praise for that kid. Come on. How many of you have been protected from a bad accident? 20 years ago. 20 years ago. We were riding in our bus going to Florida as God was opening doors to build that church there. That, by the way, now is completely on its own. Last week, they began a new name, the Faith Center, and now they're completely autonomous in Florida. Isn't that a great thing? We had a terrible bus accident at 3 o'clock in the morning on I-95 in Savannah, Georgia. My wife lay in the hospital with 9 broken ribs, broken collarbone, broken nose, punctured lung. And at that point, she had been diagnosed with asthma. I'm going to tell you how good God is. I said, I want to tell you how good God is. Not only did God heal her of all those broken ribs, but when the whole thing was done, the asthma was gone too. Somebody ought to say glory. And there she is. Stand, honey, stand. There she is. Still standing. I don't know what you came in here with today. I don't know what's going on in your life, but I'm telling you, God has a rest for you, a place of supreme peace and trust and confidence and leaning on the everlasting arms of Jesus. I came to tell you today that however the devil has tried to destroy you, I cancel every one of his assignments against you, and I declare over you today a peace that passes all understanding, that guards your heart, your mind in Christ Jesus. Get on your feet and praise him for a moment. Come on. Now let me teach you some doctrine. The rest is not the Sabbath day. The church has been sold a bill of lies. There is no special day in the kingdom of God. Here's what the psalmist said. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. I don't care if it's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, or Sunday. You want to worship God on Saturday? Go right ahead. But leave me alone when I worship him on Sunday. Amen. The Sabbath of the Old Testament was speaking symbolically of something that was to come. And that was a rest. That was not a day. It was a position. Oh, come on. Come on, somebody. Not a day, a position. Are you going to live 6 days out of the 7 days of your week without Sabbath? Somebody might have got that. I hope somebody did. Well, we rest on Sabbath day. No, we rest on every day. Because it's not about a day. And when Jesus came, he became our Sabbath. So there is no longer a special day of Sabbath. If you want to keep it, go right ahead. But don't keep going back and dabbling in that old covenant that has now been fulfilled by the Lord Jesus. Then don't tell me that I'm missing God because I don't have church on Sabbath. I do have church on Sabbath. Because every day I'm in church, it's a Sabbath. Ludicrous. And there's a bunch of people in the body of Christ that are buying that lie. Going right back to the religious things that God has delivered us from. And every time we make a day the Sabbath and not Jesus the Sabbath, Amen. We dishonor the sacrifice of the Son of God on Calvary. Last week we looked at a generation that missed God because of unbelief. They missed God because they didn't trust God. I'm not going to miss God because I don't trust Him. I don't know who's going to join me in this room. No, I'm not going to. I said, I'm not going to miss God because I don't trust Him. There was a rest denied because of unbelief. Are you still with me? The Bible says in Romans chapter 10 and verse 16, they have not all obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? Who has believed the true report? Who believed this God that he's a miracle God? That he can heal a cancer? that he can cancel a mortgage? Yeah. That he can bring a wayward son back home. Who has believed this true report that the God we served is a God that restores our youth? Who is this God that we serve that can heal psoriasis? Who can touch an arthritic spine? Who has believed this report that he can wipe out stomach ulcers? Who has believed this report that he can cure diabetes? Who has believed this true report that the God we serve is bigger than the devil that tries to test us? Who has believed this true report today? Somebody say amen with me. Who has believed in this God who can give us houses we didn't build? Who can make us drink from wells we didn't dig? Pick fruit from trees we didn't plant. Amen. Who has believed this true report that the God we serve is bigger, greater, stronger, more powerful than any power on this earth? Yep. I just heard it. Where are those wives in this room that you have been told you cannot have children? Get on your feet right now. I'm talking about a wife now. A wife. You said, they told you you cannot have children. Where are they? See, she said, I ain't getting on my feet. I'm coming. Let's go. Come on. Come on, Blondie. Come on, Blondie. Blondie's my wife. Any other lady, you better get up here real quick. Come on, come on, come on, come on, you wives. Come on, anybody else, quick. Go ahead, honey, start laying your hands on them. Yeah, everybody point your fingers, say yeah. Be fruitful and multiply. Say it out loud. Say it out loud. Be fruitful and multiply. Yeah, there it is. There it is in the name of Jesus. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. Now, I say to these wives, you know how you have children, right? You have to plant seed. So go be fruitful and multiply. And 9 months from now, we'll dedicate your babies like we're dedicating them on the stage today. Give God a praise right now. Come on. You can go back. You can go back. We're done. Let's, you know what we need to do? We just need to give a big laugh. Come on. Give a big laugh. I don't know which one of you ladies, but one of you is going to have twins. It's probably her. Go ahead and just laugh a little bit. When you are resting in God, you keep your eyes on Jesus. Oh, I need to say that again. You're going to begin to get distracted by things around you. And believe me when I tell you this, the devil will raise up people that are close to you to try to talk you out of your blessing. When I say close to you, I mean in your circle of friends. Not necessarily your mate or your brother, natural brother or sister, but somebody in your circle of friends will try to tell you, that's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard in my life. You're 60 years old. You're going into business. You ought to be retiring. You look them back in the face and say, you retired.
How about that?
In fact, you look retired already. In fact, you look tired, so you don't have to retire. Got to watch the people that you circle yourself with. I don't need any Job's comforters around me. Trying to talk me out of the blessing of God.
Amen.
Bad enough that I have to deal with the devil's attacks.
Yes.
Then I have to deal with people's attacks. Oh, but watch what I'm about to tell you. You're not going to like this. They are actually one and the same.
Yes.
Because the devil never shows up with big horns.
Right.
He shows up with people that you're accustomed to hearing.
Amen.
And it brings me back to the book of 2 Chronicles. Because I want to share this and then I'm closing. It's the story of Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat was now in a very vulnerable place. The children of Moab and Ammon and the Ammonites came up, and there is actually such a great multitude against them that the Bible says they were actually so long, so big, that it caused fear to come on them. Literally, thousands and thousands and thousands of the enemy. But here's what the Bible says. Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord. I preached a message on this many years ago because when I began to look at that word seek, it actually means to beat a path to God.
Amen.
And I remember very vividly telling the story about when we were kids in our neighborhood. How many know that years ago, there were no Home Depots,
that's right.
Walmarts,
yes, that's right.
There were no ShopRites,
that's right.
We did our business at the corner deli. In fact, when my mother would tell me to go buy a loaf of bread and a dozen eggs and a pound of bacon. Yeah, we ate bacon back then. I'd walk into the store and I'd tell Michael in Michael's Deli, my mother said to put it on the books. How many know what I'm talking about? And he'd take out the little book that he had and he'd write it all down in the book. And then he'd say, tell your mother she owes me, and whatever the thing was. Down at the corner of our block, there was an empty lot. And when we walked down the end of the street and onto the other street to go to the deli, we never walked on the sidewalk. We always walked through the middle of the lot. It was what our shortcut was. How many remember the shortcuts? We had walked on that thing so much from our neighborhood that we had beaten a path along there where no grass and no weeds grew. You're not hearing me. We walked on it so much that no weeds and no grass would grow there. We made our own sidewalk. And when I thought about this word in the Hebrew, that Jehoshaphat set his face to seek the Lord, it actually means in the Hebrew to beat a path. Yeah. When you beat a path to God, no weeds can grow on that path. Somebody ought to shout glory. This is an amazing story. He said, Lord, and I want you to understand something. When you get into a precarious situation in your life, do yourself a favor. Not because God has a short-term memory or that he ever forgets, but just remind them of his word. I hope I'm telling somebody something that'll change your life forever. You remind God of his word. Jehoshaphat said, hey, Lord, aren't you the one that rules over the kingdoms of the earth, and in your hand there's not power and might so that none is able to withstand you? Aren't you the God who drove out the inhabitants of the land before the people of Israel and gave it to the seed of Abraham, your friend, forever? Aren't you that same God? And didn't you say that when evil comes on us, at the sword or judgment or pestilence or famine, we stand before this house and in your presence, for your name is in this house, and we cry unto you in our affliction that you would hear and help us? Didn't you say that? Yes. He's reminding God. Again, he's not reminding God because God forgets. Right. He's actually reminding himself of what God said he would do when we seek him. I need a little help right there. So he said, I want you to look at all these people now that have surrounded us. And behold, I say, look at how they reward us to come and cast us out of your possession that you told us we were going to inherit. Lord, won't you judge them? Oh, I like that. For we don't have any might against this great company. Neither know we what to do. And here it is. Are you ready for 2 Chronicles 20, verse 12? But our eyes are on you.
Glory.
But our eyes are on you.
Yes.
But our eyes are on you. Eyes are not on the letter we received that our house is going into foreclosure. Our eyes are not on the doctor's report that said certain things are going on in our bodies. Our eyes are not on the critics that are telling us we can never get to our destiny.
Right.
Our eyes aren't even on the devil.
That's right. Thank God.
Our eyes are fixed on you. Our eyes are on you. Where are your eyes today? Where are your eyes? What are your eyes fixed on? Huh? And here, I'm done. I can't preach anymore. The Lord said, I know you don't have any might in the natural to do this. So here's what I want you to do. Appoint some singers and some praisers.
Hallelujah.
Oh, he came right on cue. Look at him, that young man right there. He came right on cue. I'm talking about you, Israel. By the way, most of you don't know his name is Israel. Isn't that great? I like what he said to me the other night. He said, no, my name is not Jacob, it's Israel. Anybody that's got some scripture, you know what that means. You singers better get up there. Now watch this. They appointed praisers. There's something about praise. I might be old-fashioned, Daryl. And I like to worship. I love you, Lord. But something happens to me when I hear, the enemy is defeated. And we have the victory. And maybe I'm dating myself, but I still like, oh, victory in Jesus. There's something about when you get your eyes off the enemy and get your eyes on Jehovah. The first thing that has to change is you. Because when you change, it don't make a difference what's changing right now around you. You don't even care because your eyes are fixed on him. And as they began to sing and praise God, the Lord said, ambush me. He surrounded the enemy supernaturally. Your cause is going to be answered by a supernatural God who has supernatural ability to do super abundantly before all you could ask or think, without you even being nervous and upset. I'm just resting in you. I'm going to sing praise, and you can take care of the enemy, God. The old story is told of a woman who was up at the altar one night. She was just carrying on, just praising God out loud. Glory to God. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. And the preacher walked over to her and tapped her on the shoulder and said, ma'am, don't you know when Solomon built the temple, they were very quiet? She said, I ain't building a temple. I'm blasting a foundation. I know you were raised in a Latino church. It's amazing. We got staff pastor that's Cuban and one that's Dominican. Amen. And one that's Puerto Rican. And in the natural, they don't always get along. You probably didn't know that, but I do and they do. But how God brings us together to look over. But one thing you remember when you were raised up in your church, the people knew how to shout. And when a shout came out, they didn't have a whole lot of word in them. But when that shout came out, the devil's kingdom came tumbling down. We've missed that shout in the church today. You know why? Because our faith is not in the God that we serve. We remind God of his word. Didn't you say that you were my healer? So I say to this thing that's trying to attack my body, it gets out of my body right now. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to fix my eyes on you, and I'm going to praise you. Now, you all can't sing standing back there. Let's go. I don't know who needs that rest today, but this rest says, my eyes are on you. I'm looking to you, the author, finisher, perfecter of my faith. Looking up to Jesus. That's an amazing scripture. Who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is now sit down at the right hand of the Father. Somebody's coming out of your misery today. Somebody's coming out of your problems today. Somebody's coming out of your testing today. Somebody's coming out of that sickness today. Somebody's coming out of that financial problem today. Somebody's coming out of that bad marriage today. Where are my ministers? Come up here with me, all my ministers. You know what we're going to do? Huh? Every one of you. You know what you're going to do with me? You're going to be the people that are going to lead the praise. I know some of you might be quiet, but when I give the address to do it, we're going to... Here's the Puerto Rican right here. Come on, get over here with your Latino buddies. Oh, glory to God. I'm telling you, we're going to... These people are going to release the praise. And if you have... If you have anything that you're going through right now, here's what you're going to do. When I give that key to do it, they're going to start yelling. They're going to start praising. And if, get up on your feet, everybody. Come on, come on. And you're going to run down to here and get in this glory that's over here right now. I know somebody say, well, the glory's in my seat. There it is, but there's more glory right here, right now. I fix my eyes on you, Jesus. 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 Are you all ready? I said, are you ready? Let's go. Shout it out. Come on.
Come on.
Then I miss me.
Listen to me. Listen to me, please. Listen to me, please. Listen to me, please. If you have had dislocated bones, broken bones, infected bones, anything with bones, some misplaced bones, whatever, put your hand up.
Hallelujah.
Anything with bones. In fact, if you can, try to get up here to the front. Push your way up to the front. Come on. Anything with bones. Broken bone, dislocated bone. Don't, the rest of you, don't go back. I need your praises right now. Anything with bones. Get up on that stage. You need to sing with them. Come on. Come on, Gene. Give them a microphone. I speak over you right now. Whatever the devil's trying to do in your head, I break his assignment right now in Jesus' name. That mean anything to you? Now, you people that came here with bone stuff, how many of you would know immediately if something happened, if there was a miracle? How many would know immediately? Would it be a pain that would go? Would it be something you could feel? Talk to me. Anybody? You'd be able to know. You'd be able to know. Do you understand that when you moved up here, you moved into the presence of God? See, sometimes people think we make this stuff up, that this is hysteria, emotion. Guess what? We are emotional people. Bones are mending right now. Broken bones, dislocated bones, bones that have been broken in an accident. Healing that has never taken place. Teresa, put your hands on that lady right now. That shoulder is going back into place right now. Yes. Tell her to raise her hand up. Tell her to raise her arm. Put that other arm up. Put that arm up. I want you to see if there's any pain in there right now. Check it out. I want you to move it up and down. What was wrong with it? Put your hand right on it. You haven't, does it give you any problem? Every time you carry anything heavy, move it around. Go up, go down, go back. I wish I had something heavy for you to carry. In the name of Jesus. What happened to you, sweetheart? Your knee? Walk up here. Walk up here. Walk up here. Come on, don't be ashamed. Don't be afraid. Man, if you can wear them heels, you can have a good knee. Check it out. Check it. Move it. Did you hurt it in an accident? While you were dancing? Want to dance again? Want to dance right now? Give me one of your dancers. Come on, girls. You're embarrassed? You're shy? I'm going to unshy you right now. Let those girls do. Come on. Come on. This is awesome, isn't it? Don't you love the Holy Ghost? These are all dancers. You know what they're going to do? They're going to sing again in a minute, and when they start singing, they're going to dance, and you're going to follow them. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Got any pain in your knee right now?
The
no pain.
Here.
Look at them heels. Hold on. We're not done yet. Hold on. In the name of Jesus. Sir, what's wrong with you? Yeah.
The healer is here.
Your finger gets numb. It gets stuck. Move it. Notice any difference? You notice a difference? Now, come on up here. Come on up here. Show everybody. That finger would get stuck. Notice any difference? What? Yeah, it's free. Free. And it'll never come again, in Jesus' name. All right, let's go. What's wrong with you? Knee and back. Okay, step back. Bend down, touch your toes. 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 Any pain in your back? Any pain in your back? Look up at me. Any pain in your back? No pain. Move your knee. Ah, glory to God. You said you broke your arm? You have what? Can you move it like this? Come up here. Are you all getting impatient? Only people get impatient are ones trying to get in for second service, not you. You ready? Are you ashamed and embarrassed too? Put your arm up, straighten it out. Has it ever been that straight since it broke?
No.
Put it down, go like this. Come on, move it. Go like this, watch me. Like you're lifting a weight, ready? Go like this. So who cares about the rod? You think the Holy Ghost cares about a rod? Move it. Any pain? In Jesus' name, I thank you that rod becomes a bone. Ooh, that's an amazing thing.
Yeah.
Move it. Go ahead. Look at how straight it is now. I was watching you down there. You couldn't move it like this. Is that right? Come on, somebody give God the praise. The big bunion on your foot went down while we were praying. Oh my God.
Hey!
Yeah, Jesus' name. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Let that power go in you right now. Jump up on your feet. Jump up and down. Jump up and down.
Yeah.
Any pain? In the name of Jesus, every one of you experience the power of God right now. Move something. Do something you couldn't do. Come on. Do something you couldn't do. Move your leg. Move your back. Go down. Do something.
The healer is here. The healer is here.
Ready? Enemy's been defeated. Come on. You guys got to do some dance. Come on.
Come on!
Maybe you got a new dancer now, huh? Say, maybe you got a new dancer now. She's a pretty little thing, isn't she?
Hallelujah.
Listen to me. Your miracle is as close as your praise. You declare every bone in your body is exactly the way God created it to be. You declare every organ in your body is how God created it to be. Your praise releases your victory. Just before Sammy prays the prayer of salvation, give the Lord a one big more shout of praise right now.
Precious anointing.
Hallelujah.
Well, there is people here that you have never made Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life, and it's as simple as this: praying this prayer, the prayer of salvation. You just receive it. So repeat after me. Say, Heavenly Father, I thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for paying the penalty so that I can be saved. I receive the precious gift of salvation. And from this day forward, I call myself saved, a child of God, full and surrounded with your favor. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Please, just a couple of more seconds. If you prayed that prayer for the very first time, would you please just raise your hand right there where you are? God, I see that hand. I see that hand. Anybody else? Anyone else? I see that hand, sir. God bless you. Is there anyone else? Anybody else? We have a gift. We have a Bible and a book for you. If you go to my left over here, there's some people that we're going to give you a Bible and a book. And we just welcome you to the family of God. Today is the first day of the best days of the rest of your life. Amen. God bless you, church. Continue worshiping and praising God. We'll see you on Thursday night.